Vivet Therapeutics is a dedicated company to liver metabolic disorders, and we're really focusing on gene therapy specifically. And the company was built around different perspectives, mostly around the idea was really to build the company with the CIMA Center, where Gloria Gonzalez, our chief scientific officer, is the head of the gene therapy group and has the ability to have all the gene therapy tools and ability for translational perspectives. So here we're really dedicating a strong collaboration and exclusive collaboration over liver metabolic disorder, and we started with the Wilson's program, which I will emphasize later on. So to construct the company and to build the company around this, we're really focusing on liver-tropic AAV serotype. And also, we need to understand that in gene therapy, if you want to treat some metabolic disorder affecting the children, you definitely need to have a sustainability of expression. And that's one of the things we definitely want to develop, and also work on the re-administration potential, combining both the sustainability and the ability to retreat the patient eventually. So to do that, we actually raised 2 years ago a Series A of $37.5 million with well-known investors like Novartis Venture Fund, Roche Venture, HealthCap, two Spanish funds, Isios and Columbus Venture Partner, and Kerma Partner in France. So we're leading five programs, and I will give you details on two. And based on that, we also developed a strong IP program. And recently, we signed a deal with Pfizer, and this was announced 1 month ago in the press. So we're extremely happy with this partnership. Pfizer has gained an option to actually acquire the company based on certain clinical data of the Wilson disease. And we have a strong collaboration on the Wilson's program and on the other research activity. And that's given us a very nice perspectives in the involvement of the next step and development for the company. So what we do is mostly targeting these very specific monogenic disorders. And Wilson's disease, as you will see, actually has multiple complications, and the current treatment are not very satisfactory. There's a lot of patients actually gain liver failure, and actually between 5 to 13% of patients can lead to liver transplantation. Side effects have major side effects within the current treatment. And the cost of the treatment can be extremely expensive, specifically in the US. So what we are looking at is really to mimic the liver transplantation when adding the gene therapy, and I'll show you the strong proof of concept data we have established. The other disorders are biliary deficiency, what called progressive familial inherited cholestasis, and this disorder lead to biliary salt increase in the liver or deficiency in the phospholipid secretion, like phosphatidylcholine, which lead to the increased detergent effect, clearly, of the biliary salts. And that's affecting much less patients, so it's more ultra-rare disorders, as is citrullinemia, which is a urea cycle disorders. So what we've built within the company is a real ability to optimize the construct, and not only around these multiple disorders, but also additional disorder we've not revealed today. And also have this collaboration with the CIMA, the ability to really optimize all of the different steps from the translational perspective with all the tools. We're also working, and I will detail that, for the children disorder, specifically PFIC2 and PFIC3, which actually lead to liver transplantation in a mean age of 15 to 20 years old, if not earlier, especially for PFIC2, which is much more severe. And we have analyzed all of our capabilities and strong network of the famous 3P, the physicians, the payers, and the patients, understanding the expectation and the high unmet medical need. So if we look at the Wilson disease and do a focus on the Wilson disease specifically, there's a recent paper that has been published in Journal of Hepatology, and the team with Gloria has really made a tremendous work around the Wilson. If you look at the model we are using, there's a very significant evolution over the inflammation, over the single cell necrosis, and over the liver hypertrophy, and you can see the very significant deterioration of the tissue. So what we've been doing is we've been constructing a very specific Wilson ATP7B gene, because the Wilson disease is pretty simple. It's linked to the fact that we have a deficiency in the ATP7B gene, and that restores the normal copper elimination. So what's happening in the patients is having an accumulation in the liver, an accumulation of the free copper in the circulation, in the blood, and then in the brain, which leads to very significant liver and neurological outcomes. Between, depending on the country, between 40 to 60% of the patient can be diagnosed either by liver origin or by neurological origin, having Parkinson's symptoms at the age of 30 or 40 years old, for example. So clearly what has been shown in the different experience, and I will show a little bit more, is that the delivery of the functional ATP restored the normal biliary excretion of the copper, which lead to the elimination of the copper in the feces, and it restored all of the safe copper transportation with increase in ceruloplasmin, which is a bound copper we have in the blood, which prevent this accumulation in the brain at the end of the day. And we do believe that it represents a phenotypical cure with one single administration. So what we've done as well is we look, and if you remember the historical data on the model, we look at different stages of the disease, and you can see that whatever the stage of the disease actually, there's no pointer working, obviously, no. And we've been able to reduce the copper removal from the liver, even at severe phases. And when we look at the neurological outcome, we've also been able to prevent the accumulation of the copper in the brain. And that's very significant in terms of what you could expect. And that's really mimicking the liver transportation, which generally lead to 70% of the patient will have an extremely significant improvement, 20% we have a mild, moderate improvement, and 10%, depending on the severe neurological status, may have no improvement at all at the end of the day. So what we've been thinking about is how are we going to demonstrate this in an expedited way, I would say, and reliable way for human application. Years ago, it's been published a lot of data, actually, on the use of copper 64, which is a radiolabeled copper. And you can see that in the black bars, the elimination in the feces of the patient through the biliary elimination. You can see that in the more called the pre-treatment patients, that they have almost zero elimination in the feces. And when you treat patients with chelators, the only thing you do actually is you eliminate and force the elimination of the excess copper in the urine without eliminating the accumulated copper in the liver. So what we did is we mimicked this model of copper 64 by actually using the animal model. And on the third part, you will see the Wilson disease model accumulating significantly in red, the copper 64. And on the right side of the graph, you can see the actually elimination and the copper after 24 hours and 48 hours in the biliary duct and in the intestine and in the feces of the animals. And when you look into the details, we can clearly see that we can actually mimic close to the heterozygous or homozygous animals using female animals, which are the most difficult to treat in mice, and this is why we believe we can restore fully the copper elimination from the patients. So having said that, what we've been discussing with the agencies is really to look at how we could actually mimic this in human and in Wilson's patients. So classically, we will initiate from early 2020 this dose-ranging escalation study, but more importantly, what we'll be doing is really mimic the screening of what we've shown in the mice. So what we're going to do is we're going to do a copper 64 testing before we're going to treat the patient with the gene therapy. After 12 weeks, we will repeat this copper 64, and we'll be able to show whether or not they are responder or non-responder of this gene therapy program. And if they are responder, they will be withdrawn from any residual treatment, and eventually we'll measure the sustainability over 36 weeks and more long-term perspectives. So this has been discussed, and this study will start in the first part of 2020. That will give us a very strong outcomes on the reliability of the translational data and the perspective we can have for the Wilson's patients. The other programs we want to update, and there will be a presentation at the AAGCT, is the progressive familial intrahepatic cholestasis of type 3, which is, as a type 2, a deficiency in the bile, actually, secretion. And what you can see is that there's an accumulation of the bile into the liver, and the MDR3 gene specifically is in the deficiency in the phospholipid, which actually prevent for eliminating the detergent effect of the bile. And that leads to extremely severe consequences with cholangitis, and in PFIC 2, as in PFIC 3, most of them can either have a biliary diversion, or they can have a liver transplantation, or they will die at the age of 15, 20 at the end of the day. So what we've done is we've mimicked this MDR3, and you see that in the second, in the two graph on the left, the expression after 1 week and after 12 weeks of the MDR3 compared to the wild type. And what we really extremely, you can see, is the decrease in the bile salt in the male and in the female, and decrease in the liver enzymes as well. And that's clearly showing 12 weeks post-treatment an extremely durable effect. And interestingly, when we look at the bile phosphocholine expression, it's been recently published that within only 15% of restoration of the bile phosphatidylcholine, you can actually prevent the detergent effect of the bile salts into the bile duct, basically. And that can be shown as well in the organ size. So if you look at the spleen here, you see the size difference, and the liver weight is close to normal at the end of the day. So this program has been a really an interesting program, and we will actually start the IND enabling study in the second part of this year. Looking at the unmet medical needs we still have in gene therapy, which are the two key questions, and can we retreat, and can we actually have the ability to have duration of expression in patients? So we're not detailing what we're doing precisely, but we have developed a specific modality in terms of sustained expression, and what we've been able to show is that when you treat animal at 3 weeks, and if you double the size of the liver at 6 weeks, we can clearly show there's a stabilization of the expression and of the protein excretion despite doubling the size of the liver. So that's something very important for us, which we can apply on the PFIC animals if necessary and if applicable, and we can also apply on other urea cycle disorders and any kind of disease when you need to treat the children. And the other part is the immune tolerance. So there's multiple work being done on how to modify the capsid to make it more preventive in generating neutralizing antibody, on how can you eliminate the neutralizing antibody to actually retreat. And that's two key challenges we are addressing at Vivet Therapeutics. So thank you. And this is the global portfolio. So we have the IND and the CTA early 2020 for the Wilson's, and we'll be establishing the other program in the next 2 years for additional INDs, and we have some lead being selected and the technology being applicable to the other programs, and that's giving us a strong portfolio and trust perspectives, and on top of the collaboration and partnership with Pfizer. Thank you for your attention.